Tomer, usually we start with a little background. Where did you grow? Where did you come from? How did your the place you grew and your parents and your family and the business, how did it affect your business today? So basically, where did you grow?
I was born in Afula. It's a town here in Israel, for those of you who don't know. At the age of six, I moved with my family to South America, to Peru. Spent there 9 years. So my Spanish is actually much better than my English and my Hebrew. And came back after 9 years to La Nana. And yeah.
Actually, Afula was my home seat. I mean, I was not born in Afula, but as we spoke before, I was born in a small kibbutz. It's even a smaller hole than Afula, actually. And yeah, 15 minutes for Afula. So when we wanted to eat falafel, do anything, we went to Afula or Bet Yan.
Yeah. I know two entrepreneurs that grew up in Afula. Also, Kobi Menachemi from CrossRider also was born in Afula, yeah. So apparently the garinim were very good. I came back to Ranana, where I was raised with my family, and then after that, army, Tel Aviv. Now I live in Tel Mond.
Okay. Ah, you shouldn't say Tel Mond. People gonna, you know, come and take pictures and stuff. And, you know.
Okay. You're all invited for Pesach, but I'll be in Thailand.
And so you said you grew in Afula and you moved to Peru. How come? What made you?
You know, I was six. They didn't really ask me, but I was like a bag. They dragged me there. But you know, shit happens. I was.
But I was told you had great. I mean, like, great business. It was a great community, Jewish community in Peru, in Lima, actually.
Yeah, it's a huge community of 2,000 people. And it's very characteristic. I don't know, how many of you have been to South America? Yeah, so you know it. It's the regular, like, Jewish community, very small, very closed. My 9 years in South America, actually, it's a nice story. All my 9 years in Peru, I never ever walked the streets alone. As a kid, they drive you to school, they drive you from school, they send you to the different hobbies, whatever you do. Always they take you, it was too dangerous.
What a degrade to go back to Israel, isn't it? You had to brush your teeth alone and walk for school alone.
Well, actually I was very spoiled even when I came back, but. It was actually for me. It was every so we are four brothers and sisters, and we just moved there. Only two of us, and two stayed here. They were in the army and studying. And every summer, I would come back to Israel for 3 months, and it was amazing because all of a sudden it was like a real vacation, just because I was able to walk the streets alone. It was like going out of jail. I guess that was...
And that was the reason you came back to Israel after 9 years, right?
Actually, the reason we came back... So, essentially, we moved there. My family moved there for what was supposed to be 3 years. That ended up being nine. That's for all of us who thinks about relocating for X years and you end up staying X decades. And actually, the reason we came back is I think my father, he got... some threats
about on your life. I'm not sure
I got the story right, but I think they threatened to kidnap us and like cut our ears and send it to in envelopes. I don't know, some crazy shit. But the it was really really dangerous. And by the just to further we had no money, right? It wasn't like for. He was involved in the Jewish. My father was involved in the Jewish community, and so it was. Basically, there was Sendero Luminoso, Anativa Zoer, was one of the terrorist organizations there.
The Shining Pass.
You were also there?
No, just kidnapped.
You were kidnapped by them? No, I'm kidding.
He's still shining. So then you came back to Israel at the age of 15 and came back to Ranana, right? Or 14 or 15, came back to Ranana, right?
Correct.
Okay. four Sicilian brothers, physician, academic. One is a, what is she? Is she a kindergarten?
Yeah.
Okay. And you went to the Air Force. What did you do in the Air Force?
I was, I don't know how you say it, Ktsin Tichnun.
Okay. A planner.
usually people tend to confuse a
CPO.
Yeah. I was, people tend to confuse Ktsin Tichnun with Ktsin Tichnut. So basically, my job had nothing to do with computers.
Right.
I was basically in charge of arranging some part of the, how do you say, Binyan HaKoach, how the long-term planning of the HR and how many people you send to each unit and so on.
Right. It's a bit like what you're doing today, right? And you did that for 4 years, and then you finished the army. You were an officer for 1 year, and then Tomer, after the army, he didn't have to go to Peru because he was already there for 9 years, right? He couldn't get to go. I mean, he did. He wanted to go for a trip, for a long trip, for the South, for America, right?
Yeah, I think that's probably one of, if I had to point where was the first milestone is a big word, but the first time something external influenced my professional life was right there, because after the army, many of us, I said, okay, I'm going to work a few months as a waiter or whatever, save some money and buy a ticket to go finally visit South America that, you know, 10
Hello.
Years later...
Hello.
Without a bodyguard. Back then it was already safe. The Sendero Luminoso was out and it was okay to go visit and backpacking in South America. And so I did a survey and I, with the motivation of finding what is the restaurant that if I go and apply for a job, they will pay the highest tips.
Right.
And it was, Sagi, I don't know if you remember it, it was Columbus in Herzliya because you would sing. Happy birthday to you. and they would pay you big tips. And I started working at Columbus. And so being a waiter is a very difficult job. So you end up spending 1 week working, but without getting paid. Just
right.
It's like a non-job training kind
Stash.
Of
fun.
Yeah, it's like basically they're ripping you off. And I was working there, and it was the first shift that I was supposed to go and actually work and get paid. And on my way to the restaurant, I get a phone call from Naftali. He was someone who I worked with in the army. He was, I think, whatever. He was Aluf Mishne or something like that. He actually got released from the army 2 years before me. And I, one sunny day, I get a phone call. He says, Tomer, you left the army, you didn't call me? I said, Naftali, hey, what have you been doing? And so nice to hear from you. Anyways, he says, I need to talk to you. You need to come to my office right now. And he basically hangs up the phone. And I said, okay, I'm driving to, I spend a week working as a waiter without getting paid. There is no way I'm not showing up to my first shift. And I don't know what happened. I decided to call the owner or whatever, the shift manager in the restaurant, asking to be late for 2 hours, 1 hour, and I'll promise I'll give the hours back. She fired me on the phone. she fired me on the phone, and she was kind enough to tell me, and don't come here even as a guest.
Not
I swear. And I said, okay, wow. I do a U-turn and I drive into Naftali's office. You can imagine I was really pissed off and said, okay, I just lost my job because of you. And long story short...
He was working in Microsoft at that time.
He was working in Microsoft, and long story short, 2 weeks later, I find myself living in Seattle, working for Microsoft, no previous knowledge of computers, and I got, you know, my friends were all working at gas stations and stuff, and I suddenly got an apartment in Seattle, a job at Microsoft, and a car, and I said, okay, this is amazing. And I said, Naftali, and I'm going to be there, but then you're also going to buy me the ticket to South America.
So eventually, you didn't go to South America?
I did.
No, not at this point.
Yeah, I spent
you
a few months, yeah, and then went to South America.
And so Microsoft, they paid for the ticket.
So I don't know who should I thank, Columbus, Naftali, both of them, but yeah.
And what did you do in Seattle?
I was in charge of a team. So basically, I was part of a team that was named NT International. Back then, it was a team in charge of localizing Windows 98 and Internet Explorer 5 to bidirectional languages, which are languages that you write right to left and left to right. And at the time, maybe it's still today, in that group, it was Hebrew, Arabic, and Thai. So the group was basically built of Israelis, Arabs, and some Thai people. So if you think about it, it's like a microcosmos of Israel today. And managing that was a real Then the Russians came. Sorry. Yeah. We love the Russians. And managing this group of people was really challenging on the cultural level. They didn't really like each other. And the guy running that team before me Naftali thought that he wanted someone with... I said, oh, Naftali, are you crazy? Why are you sending me? I don't know anything about this. He says, and then he goes, like, I need someone there with some people skills and you'll do fine. I said, okay, if you trust me, I trust myself. We'll see how it goes.
Yeah, and it's always, you know, it's the same story again and again. We hear about people saying that the most important thing is about the people that you hire. It's maybe, you know, computer science, it's important, but it's all about the people. So he brought you because he knew from the army and he said, I'm counting on you, you'll do a great job. And you've been there for about
He was simply desperate. He probably offered the job to 10 other people and said no. And so I was the last one. He said, okay, let's try.
It's a good story. After 2 years, you came back to Israel, and then you continue working for Microsoft, right? I mean, this was a great path for you.
No, actually,
no,
I decided. By the way, being one third of my life before that in South America, I knew what was it to go for a few months and then stay there for 10 years. At some point, I decided I'm going to that I want to be back home. My girlfriend back then ended up being my wife today, and. Anyway, I wanted to be here, and then I came back, not for working for Microsoft, and basically joining a few startups along the way. And
the fact that you've been living in Peru for 9 years, and after 2 years in Seattle, you came back to Israel because you wanted to live in Israel. Does this affect today some of your decisions about ironSource and growing in Israel or not?
Yeah, totally. It has different incarnations over time, but I'm very often asked by internally in the company and externally why I don't relocate myself to Silicon Valley or to New York. ironSource has offices in Tel Aviv and in New York and in San Francisco and in Beijing, and it makes it might make sense for me to buy the book, to be there, but I simply, so I said, there are two very good reasons why not relocating and staying here. The best one is because I want to live here. So I have also a personal life. And second, I think in today's world, especially on internet ventures, you don't really have to be somewhere. If you build it right, you can stay wherever you think is home for you. And to me personally, again, living so many years abroad, to me it's important to build a big company and see more bigger companies build up in Israel. And for me, it's something very important.
Okay.
Thank you.
So that was around 2000, and then you spent about 8 or 9 years working for some small startup companies in Israel. And the last one you worked with was Payoneer, right?
Payoneer.
Payoneer, anyone knows Payoneer?
Yeah.
Okay, Payoneer is a great company also
it
today.
Is.
It is, right? And at some point, and this we're going back to the teaser, at some point Payoneer had some difficulties which affected your decision to start doing something else, which eventually became ironSource. Share a bit of the story of what happened with Payoneer in 2009.
Yeah, so according to foreign newspapers, we don't know if it's true or not, Payoneer was involved in, involved is a big word, but in the, you remember the assassination of Mabkhouch in Dubai? by the Mossad. So apparently some, again, external newspaper said that those Mossad agents used the Payoneer prepaid cards to pay for whatever in the mission. Again, I don't know if it's true or not, but the company got a lot of heat, and it was really in between raising capital, and those days back then weren't so good for the company. We had to let go many people. I moved. I was VP marketing there. I moved to work as a freelancer, as an giving some services to the company. And basically, those were days where I was basically making no money. Right. So yeah.
And then I mean, from being VP marketing for a nice company, growing company, in this event, you kind of had like kind of stop, kind of break in your career, and you had, as you said, you stopped earning, you know, money or salary. And at this time, you cooperate or you met your friends from the past, right? And then you thought about like new ideas of how to make money, like passive money, right? Mm-hmm. So what was like the idea? What did you try to do at this time?
It was very simple. We had no idea, but we just knew we needed money. So myself and the other three brothers, Midrod brothers, we started developing stuff, consumer products that we wanted to find ways to monetize, to distribute and monetize, and be able to generate an income for ourselves. The goal back then was to generate a few thousand dollars each a month. And that was the only thing we were focusing on. No big idea
very
of building.
Focused.
We were very focused on that. At that time, back then, we didn't have an idea, or we didn't meet. I often say I don't have a romantic story about three founders meeting in some basement to change the world. It was just us wanting to make a living. I was basically broke, and so were the other two. The third brother was doing fine, and that was basically what we were doing.
So what did you do? I mean, did you establish a company, or you just develop something, you know, just some kind of application or a game?
Yeah, we developed few applications. The most successful one was FoxTab. It was a browser add-on, initially for Firefox and then for Chrome, that you would install and rearrange, basically provide you a 3D view of your browser. Somehow we managed to drive a lot of attention to that add-on, and I think 10 or 12 million people downloaded it. Back then it was a huge number.
Wow. Which year was it?
It was late 2009. Mid-late 2009, yeah. So you were one of the those 12 million? Yeah. Yeah. I actually thought it was nonsense. I was not using it. But 12 million people were using it, and it was great. I think it's a good example, because back then we didn't fall in love with a product. It wasn't the main motivation to like generate the next YouTube or whatever. It was we said, okay, we're going to develop many consumer products. We're going to start driving traffic to those products and hopefully being able to monetize them. And it so happened that FoxTab was one of the main ones that we wanted, that we managed to monetize. And through that, we discover the inefficiencies in that part of the business that eventually motivated us to transform that into what ironSource is today.
Right, so like in many other cases, you had this huge challenge with all these applications, and you thought all the other solved these, you know, the challenges of installation and stuff. Mm-hmm. And so you start building for your own, like an installer, right? That was the first,
yeah,
like the beginning of ironSource.
Kind of, yeah.
Kind of, okay.
Yeah, I think one of the previous sponsors, she said that, she likes to eat her own dog food. Yeah, yeah, and I remember that sentence because I often say that sometimes I say we like to eat at our own restaurant. It's a bit nicer. But being a software developer, we face the same challenges that today we serve software developers. Back then, 4 or 5 years ago, we were one of them, and we're facing the same challenges that millions of developers out there face, which is which the main ones are, other than the milestone of developing the initial product. I believe few of you, I'm sure, are either developing a product or thinking about it. So developing the product is the first initial challenge, which is very important. You need to develop great products. But once you have the product, the real challenges really begin, because you need to be able to get it to an audience of users that might be interested in your product. And now that you have the product and you have the audience, you need to actually deliver the product to those users. That's also a challenge. To monetize those free installations, it's also a challenge. And we're facing those challenges ourselves. And back then, we assumed that all the other developers out there had the same challenges, but they had solved their own problems. And it ended up being that that was a wrong assumption. And the same problem that we had, so many other people had, and we thought that we could fix, and we fixed for ourselves some of those problems, and then transform it into a platform where we would give that solution also to other people like us.
When did you realize that you have like a real amazing technology or amazing solution, and you moved from like solving your own challenges to a new company called the ironSource start booming?
So the question is, when did I realize I have something?
Yes, something very, very interesting.
I'm still waiting for that day, but No, look, I think it's it took us very, very. We almost immediately realized the potential that we had. We saw it in the numbers. We saw it in the growth, and we were able to build a thesis of how we see things moving forward. I think the first I would say one major milestone for us was a few months, half a year after we started the operations, we got the first offer to sell the company. It was for a significant amount, where we had 100% of the company, and in terms of exits, that would be a major outcome for the founders. And we decided not to go. We eventually decided not to go for that offer. And the
why? No, this is a great question.
Why?
They were almost broke 4 years before. I mean, the company was not that big at that time. And you were offered a lot of money. I mean, you told us, you can maybe tell them, but you were offered a lot of money at this point, 100%.
Yeah. I think that would categorize into ish feuds manit. I don't know how you say that, but no. Look, it's we at the point where we got that offer, we knew we had something serious in our hands, but I'd be fair and say we didn't know the full potential, and we didn't even dream about how big it can get, which it did. But I think the major one of the partners, Itai, that you remember I said three of us were broke, one of us had some money. So he was the one who said, okay, we don't need to sell. But it took him really minutes to convince all the other three, because we had a clear conviction on what we want to do, and we thought that the chances of being successful are fair. And we like what we do and decided to stick into it.
So, can you tell us today, where is ironSource today?
It's right here, across the place. It's like in the street. It's ironSource today is a big internet company operating, again, from Israel and other locations. We still connect developers to users across all their devices, desktop, mobile, and so on. The concept that we, or our vision is that developers, if you think about the way developers still develop a product today, they are very device-centric. I mean, developers develop solutions for our mobile phones, our laptops, our tablets, and we think that is something that has to fundamentally change. Developers need to focus on developing products for the end users and not for the end user's device, because in 1 or 2 years from now, if you develop a product, which is, by the way, my view on this, if you are thinking about developing a product and you don't see how you can do it user-centric across all their devices, My bet is that products that will not be cross-device, cross-connected, will not be here in 1 or 2 years. There is no way that we're going to, as users, use one set of products on our desktop and a different set of products on our mobile. And it's all about providing the platform for the developers to be able to concentrate in developing great products and use platform as a service like ironSource to really deliver that product to the users across all their devices at scale. And this is what we do.
How many people work in ironSource today?
How many people?
People, yeah.
About 550.
And what, yeah, 550, it's a great internet company, right? And where do you see, what's your vision for the next 5 years for ironSource?
We are in our roadmap is to continue being a great company. I don't want to overrate the world roadmap. Okay, I think it's you need to keep agile enough and constantly look at in general. I always say that the internet is not about technology or IP or it's about innovation. If you think about great services out there like Twitter and Facebook and YouTube and whatever, all the different services that you have, they're not very rich in technology. I mean, they have a lot of technology for scale, but they're mostly about innovation. And so we want ourselves to be very innovative, to be able to take advantage of opportunities that we see in the market. And that's the DNA that I think we build and maintain in the company. We plan to be as opportunistic as we can and as strategic as we can into sustaining that. And hopefully continue building a big company.
You told me the goal is to be one of the largest, or one of the top 10 internet companies in the world.
Yeah.
So that's a great, great goal. Yeah.
Thank you.
Let's go for that.
From Israel.
From Israel, right? Not to be sold before.
Stay in Israel.
Yeah.
And another thing very interesting about ironSource is that the company is about 5 years old, 500 people. It's a big business today. But you just recently, like in the last 6 months, it's the first time you were invested, funded, right?
Yeah.
So how come? I mean, how come 5 years? Most of the startups in the room, entrepreneurs today, they're looking for seed money and then second round, you know, they get look founded and then, you know, and whatever, looking for investment. But you did all that alone, and you could sell, but you didn't. And you keep on doing that for 5 years, and suddenly, and you're earning money today, right? You have like a positive revenue. And now you were funded by, I mean, you had like 150 million investment during the last 6 months with two rounds.
Yeah, it's one round. I'll elaborate a bit.
Yeah.
I also, since day one, had few very important beliefs, whatever. One of them was we are a for-profit organization. Okay, we believe in companies that are profitable. There's nothing wrong with companies that are not profitable. It's okay, but then you enter a path where, by definition, you will need to raise money, get diluted, build your vision, and that's great. But it's a question of what fits your DNA and the DNA of your group. In our case, we believe in building sustainable standalone companies, and I didn't want to waste, or maybe I should say invest, half a year every year raising capital, which is effectively what happens to a lot of entrepreneurs. So we were very focused on finding the areas of growth that we think we can maintain ourselves and grow organically and build an ROI positive company ourselves. At some point we decided we're going to grow both organically and non-organically, meaning through M&As, and we used also the cash and the profit that we generate to expand the company through acquisitions, and we've done six of those. One of them, we acquired a company that was a portfolio company of Carmel Ventures, and through that acquisition, Carmel became also shareholders in ironSource. And then the next round that we did was about half a year ago, where we raised over $100 million, and it was the first institutional raise that we did. And still, the founders of the company, we still own around 75% of the
That's
company.
That's amazing. 75% this time, this is amazing.
Yeah. And so, but what I'm saying is what? Yeah, it's like, I don't have a best practice. There is nothing wrong with going on the other track where you raise capital and then you build a company. But to me, if you want to build a company for an exit, then it's okay to do that. If you want to build, and seriously, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. If you want to build a sustainable company that could potentially become bigger and bigger, and so you need the right fundamentals. Being able to build a healthy business that can grow both on the top line revenues and on the bottom line and maintain profitability and use that profit to grow is a practice that we like very much and we plan to maintain. And I see more and more entrepreneurs and companies in Israel adopting that concept, and I think it's very healthy. Companies should earn money and should be profitable. That's the way. That's my philosophy. That's the way we see things in ironSource, and that's how we operate.
The fact that you raised $105 million for more acquisitions just recently, that this means that you are not aiming to go public during the next year?
We are not
going to go public.
No. By the way, the reason we raised a capital was that we wanted to expedite our growth, both organically and non-organically. And it was a good opportunity to increase the cash and also have a currency, because when you do an institutional round and you have a currency in the sense that you have equity in the company that has a clear valuation validated by corporate institutions, you can use that to also, you can use the equity and the cash to do acquisitions. The main motivation around raising that amount now was to be more aggressive on the M&A side and acquire bigger companies.
What is the evaluation of ironSource today?
I don't know.
Okay, I try.
Ask me tomorrow, maybe I'll remember.
So what kind of technology, what kind of companies are you looking for, are you focusing on? You said you're going for more M&As. What stuff are most interesting for you?
We are looking, I'll answer the following way. We are mainly focused on mobile companies. We believe a lot in our mobile growth and we want to help the organic growth of the mobile team with some external acquisitions. And we are mainly looking for companies that fit our DNA. Okay, I think the main thing is to not just find, I often say that people that are active on investments and M&As and corporate stuff, they should differentiate between a good deal and a good business. Okay, in the sense that people, all of us, by nature, we are very focused on making good deals. We want to pay as little as possible to get as much as possible, and that's fine. But I think people should mainly be focused on how to build good businesses. So we'll focus on things that we think are synergetic to ironSource and also fit our DNA and can contribute in the growth story of ironSource.
Did you meet the guys from Rapid API before? They were, I mean...
Not yet.
That might be interesting.
Okay.
They're very small, but very young also.
And from Ranana. There you go.
And Haifa. Yeah. So I'm not going to ask you about all the tips. Usually we ask entrepreneurs about the tips of how to raise money, seed money and stuff, because you just didn't. You didn't raise seed money. But I do going to ask you a very important question, which is about talent. How do you attract the best talents to work in your companies, because it's all about people, as you said.
Yeah, you know, it's a complex question. It doesn't have one single answer. But I think that the most talented people are attracted to talent, right? So talented people, they want to be part of a winning team. They want to feel that they are surrounded by people that they can learn from them. They can improve and build great stuff together. So we pay a lot of attention. You know, last year, ironSource, we hired almost 200 people in 2013. Wow. Not even one of them came through the HR agencies, the recruitment agencies. Not even one. By the way, this is something that saved the company over $3.5 million. Wow. $1 million that the company saved by not using the how you call them?
The recruitment agencies.
Yeah. And so the reason we do that is not just because we want to save that money, which again is also very important, but because we want to make sure that we find the right people for us. And if you cannot build the funnel of being exposed to the relevant users. It, by the way, it's very much like distributing an application. You want to be able to identify the right audience for you. And you want to make sure that you are the right audience for them. And you need to build that DNA within your company. And if you do it right, then it's very easy, or I would say easier, to track talent. They see the process of how you recruit people. They see how much we invest in recognizing and identifying who are the right people for us and us for them. And when you hit a critical mass, then basically you get a critical mass in terms of how many people you have, and you build the ecosystem around you, then you have an amazing flow of audience and potential candidates to join the company.
So it's basically most of your recruitment are bring friend, what we say. Right?
Yeah, I'm a big fan of working with friends and family. I have family that work with me in the company. I have childhood friends that work with me, and so I believe in that. It's like
It's like Tassia Virit.
Kind of, yeah. That was my model. Yeah.
You can go for the Knesset also very soon.
At the beginning, if you're in early stages, make sure you surround yourself by people you love, and that you want to give to them, and you think they want to give to you, and build the right energy right there, and spend a lot of time thinking who are the right people you want to invite to that party, and stick with that.
Okay, guys, any questions from the audience? Tomer. Yes, Leo.
Israeli entrepreneurs, but we're not good at growing a business. We're very good at taking an idea and making a good product, but we're not good at getting to a stage as, for example, ironSource is right now. Why is that? Why do you think it's part of our DNA, or just a phase?
Yeah, I personally think that is changing quite rapidly, but I think it's really a question of the ecosystem around the entrepreneurs. I think if you analyze in details that phenomenon, you will see that a lot of the companies are striking exits or driving through exit far too fast because of the ecosystem working around them, the investors that are looking for a nice return, and if most of the investors out there will tell you, yes, we want to build a great company. But when they are faced with 2, 3, 4 times a 4x return on their investment, they will actually want to sell. And even if they don't admit that, you see that they don't do enough, or they didn't do enough. I think that, again, fundamentally changed over the last 5 years. To help the entrepreneurs, the company, the management, to be able to do some tactic moves like taking some money out over the years in the company to make sure you give enough oxygen and energy to go a long way. So it's really a question of the ecosystem working around you, and of course your real and sincere motivation. It's okay to, I think it's a great reason or motivation to start a company, because you want to make some money, and you have the dream of an exit of millions of dollars.
Building a house in Tel Aviv.
Yes, and building a house in a full haven. but you can do that not just by an early exit, which again, I'm not against it. I think it's great and I think it helps the economy of Israel, the fact that we do so many exits. But if you really want to, if you believe in yourself and you believe in your idea and you look at the reality and really think, and again, it's really important to look at the reality and be able to tell yourself the truth. If you think you have something big, make sure you build the ecosystem around you that will support it. We've been very fortunate to have great partners together with us. Our investors, the board of directors that helps us, Carmel, I have to give, really, I love those guys. They really want to build big companies. Also the investors that we brought in currently, they know we want to build something big and support it, and they're willing to do everything that it takes to support that process.
Okay.
And I seriously think we will see more and more significant big and bigger companies, mainly on the internet industry, becoming big in Israel and not selling too early. We already see it now.
Okay, more questions? Yes, sir.
You spoke about ironSource being bootstrapped, but I think that most entrepreneurs, they find it hard to find the first $100K to develop the base product and then start to sell it and then start to get the income of it and the revenues. So my question is, if you can tip the entrepreneurs in the audience, how to start, how to make the first, the first mile until they can get initial revenue and then, cycle it.
Yeah, so look, everyone has this, that's a question that is always valid, and no one will really, I think, will ever be able to give a bulletproof answer to that.
Yeah, everyone has
his own personal experience. In my experience, or in my the way I see it, the part of the problem is that those same entrepreneurs that are looking for the first 100K are not willing to sacrifice enough. Building a company, starting a company, requires a lot to be able to sacrifice personally, and if you have a family, then your family to sacrifice a lot. When we started ironSource, again, I had no money. I could go and apply for a job somewhere, get a nice salary, and do great. But I was married. I still am. I had one kid, and my wife was pregnant with the second kid. We have two girls, and I was living at a rented apartment, which I left because I said, okay, I cannot really start the company and also have no salary. And I didn't. When we started doing this, we didn't know how fast it's going to generate cash for us, which again was the motivation to generate cash. But so I left my apartment, and I moved with my daughter, my wife, pregnant wife, to the second floor of my parents' house, and save rent, and spend there, by the way, 3 years, far more than what than I needed, because I already had the money to go and buy a house. But actually, it was very nice, and my mom is a great cook. And
it's a babysitter.
But what I'm saying, what I'm telling you all this, because effectively, if you're looking for 100K, you can like that make sure it's only 50, and maybe you can raise 50 from your friends and family, or even go and take go to the bank and take some money.
Raise debt.
Yeah. The question is how much you are willing to sacrifice, and if you're looking for the easy path, then you will always ask the question of, okay, do you have a tip how I can get to the fastest or easiest 100K? There is no such thing. The first days, the first year, raising the first dollar is extremely difficult. Try to reduce that dependency and that difficulty by measuring what's the level of sacrifice that you're willing to take. And if you're not willing to take none, then you're in deep shit. Or you need to have a lot of luck and find someone that you can pitch in 5 minutes, and then millions of dollars will...
Co-founder.
Try to find a rich co-founder. Yeah.
I would like to ask, how are you able to recognize on real time your breaking point?
My breaking point?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I... I never break. No. What? Sorry, I didn't.
The breakthrough?
Breakthrough.
So I think KPIs, or even when you just start and you have nothing at all, try to think, what are your key indicators? Maybe your key indicator is how fast you develop a product, how fast you release the product to the market, how fast you get to the first 100 users, how fast you, whatever, raise capital. And don't tell yourself stories. Okay? Try to put some milestones and see if you meet them. And if you see that you do, and you're capable of challenging yourself with serious milestones, make sure you hit them, then those are the breakthroughs. And if you do that and you adopt that mechanism, you will also have some major breakthroughs. And you will feel it. You will feel it even when no one else out there will see it. You will feel it. It's more of a feeling than a clear indicator. But follow clear indicators. See that you meet them and start feeling that confidence. If you apply that confidence with clear facts to measure them, you're on a good track.
Okay. Thank you. So today. Today you acquire companies, and people come to you. You have to, you know, to decide whether to invest or not to invest in them. What are your three most important tips for companies coming to meet you before the meeting?
The first tip is don't ever listen to anyone to tips. tips for people. In the case of ironSource, I think. I'll try to be very practical. For us, if you want to come talk to us, oh, you're asking about us or in general?
No, about you.
Try to find a clear linkage between what you do and what you think, at least, ironSource is doing. Mm-hmm. Show that you have processed something, that you have an idea of how you see these two things working together. One, two, again, being practical, try to find someone who you know and we know that can mitigate, right?
Okay. That a good reference, mutual reference.
Yeah, hopefully someone within ironSource. Mm-hmm. It helps a lot. Be passionate. I don't know. Have something that we will be very good in identifying if you really believe in what you have.
Okay. Another like, big question is like. And we are like in the last three questions, so if anyone wants to ask more questions, I will give you some more time, just think about that, okay? So yeah, one more question, the question I asked everybody is, what do you, as Tomer, what do you see as like next big thing in technology, like if you're looking in next 2 or 3 years from today?
Again, I'm not a big fan of technology, but no, seriously, I'm a big fan of innovation. I don't know, robotics, whatever. I don't know what that means. I think mobile e-commerce is very interesting. Simply because it's the world is definitely going mobile, and people buy more and more stuff. Mobile e-commerce, I think, it's a very promising vertical.
Anyone here around mobile e-commerce? One, two, three. Yeah. Okay. 3%. Okay. 2 or 3 more questions, and when we're done to last question on my behalf. So yeah.
Me?
Yeah, you.
Thanks. I'm curious about definition for entrepreneurship, and as well as the kind of
definition for. Ah, okay.
And the second question is what was the models of inspiration that took the inspiration during all the process of entrepreneurship? It's very interesting for me.
Sure. My definition of entrepreneurship, I never really thought about it. Let's see. It's, you know, it's a combination of eagerness to do something even when you know that the chances are by definition against you, because they are. and but you believe in your ability to disrupt or to transform something. Your close circle, your friends, your different industries, and you're willing to sacrifice. Again, getting to my previous point, you're willing to sacrifice something for a bigger tomorrow. Okay, that's I think how I would define it. And inspiration. Look, I am, and really, this might sound very kitsch, but I'm inspired by all the people that are around me every day. I think that I'm generally intrigued by people. I love to identify what is it that is driving a person, an individual, or a group of people. And if I manage to crack it, to understand, that inspires me, and I learn something about it. I don't have like a big name or someone who inspired and changed. I have many of those, but the real inspiration comes from the people that you have on the day-to-day. Try to look for inspiration from them. It's much more valuable than being inspired by people, by entrepreneurs that you think or not that made it, or people that you think, you know, inspiration comes from the biggest inspiration comes from the people around you that you love.
Yeah, great. Yeah. Shai.
Bit of a technical question. You mentioned apps that aren't, or companies that aren't cross platform, there's no space, there's no future for them. I was speaking to someone outside earlier about how developing native apps, there's no comparison. Are we destined to always have, you know, an iOS team, an Android team, a Mac desktop team, a PC team, or do you think that there's, you know, is HTML5 going to be a platform agnostic option? You know, talk about that.
Yeah, I think the I'll answer first the concept and then on a bit more on the technical level. The concept is if you're a product company, if you are developing a product, even if you need to have multiple teams doing iOS and Android and PC and stuff, if you're really looking to become a market leader, you need to focus on the user. Okay? If you're building a calculator, okay, and that calculator will work only on your mobile, then I think there's a good chance you'll be out of business. Maybe calculator is not a great example, but if you're a media player and it's just working on your mobile, then you carry the risk of losing your business because someone will come with a product that works across the device. Because I also want a media player on my laptop and on my tablet. And maybe for the time being, you'll have to maintain multiple teams in the migration to other platforms. And maybe in the future, we will see consolidation and we'll see a mediation platforms, like maybe ironSource will go to in that direction, that will help developers concentrate again in developing the product, and we will provide the SDKs and the APIs to automatically do the adjustment to all the platforms. But again, on the state of mind, think about what I was referring is, think about the users and not their devices. The world is going to go there. I think there is no way we will not see a consolidation around us, the end users, and being focused on just on our devices. So I think, again, it's a transition, because effectively, you do have today products that work only on desktop and products that work only on mobile. And you know, we work with some of the biggest companies out there that are clear market leaders on the desktop or clear market leaders on the mobile. And with the desktop is a great example that we work with companies that, again, are clear market leaders on the desktop, and they're really struggling converting that leadership into mobile, and they understand that they have a window of opportunity of, say, 2 years, that if they will not be able to become a cross-device company, then they will lose significant market share. And so there will be a transition, there, but eventually, I'm sure, developers are going to develop for all the devices only once.
So software developers' number is going to decrease significantly.
I don't know. I'm not sure. I'm not sure.
I would agree with you completely if it wasn't for Apple. Ah. Strategy.
Apple strategy.
But look at the following. Even Apple, you know, they have the iPhones, and they also have the Macs, right? So they also provide, and for example, they have iTunes. Okay, iTunes is a product that, it's a great example. It works both on your desktop and on your mobile, and that's the only way you can interact with your content, right, your music. So even they did it across all the devices. Now, they are a very closed garden company, right? And they, as opposed to Android, which is very open, you almost have almost zero visibility into what they're going to do next and what are the rules that they're going to follow. But even they understand that within their ecosystem, which they might open or keep closed, they understand that they need to be user-centric and not device-centric. I think that's a great example of someone who is, you know, I'm not here to defend Apple. I actually think that but on that end, they're doing a great job.
They really are.
Yeah.
They're able to maintain their position that way
yeah.
for a very long time.
Correct.
Okay, there was a very interesting point at this discussion before you said about ironSource maybe going this way, about, you know, building some kind of platform for multi whatever that was. Multi-client stuff. This was interesting. We keep on looking. Maybe this is the way ironSource is going. We will follow you, of course. The last question always in Startup Grind in Israel, and actually most of the world, is a personal question. Last question.
I'm sorry, I'm married.
I was looking at Facebook status. So yeah, the last question is what? It's a Peter Pan question. Is what are you going to do when you grow up?
I hope not to grow up and stay a kid. I hope to continue doing what I do now, but I'm trying to find an intelligent answer to this. What I plan to do when I grow up. I you know what? I just hope not to grow up. I'm sorry.
Okay, Thomas, thank you very, very much for being here.